Hello again, if you've been watching this series of tutorials. In this particular video, we're going to import the recording we've done earlier. So let's start with the login in OctoPerf. I will just submit my credentials. And I would like to get started with a new project here. So let's go ahead and call this project training. And if you remember, we did a recording with several different tools. I'm going to use the one from Fiddler, but know that there are several options you can use if you want to get a recording in OctoPerf. But the first one here is more about importing a list of URLs that you want to test. And the same goes for Selenium, but of course, if you want to make it more complex, once you're in the Selenium WebDriver interface, you can do that. For today, though, as I said, I will use the browser record and I will use the Fiddler option specifically. Just keep in mind that if you have a JMeter project, you're also welcome to import it. And everything you can do in JMeter can be imported in OctoPerf. Anyway, let's select browser record. That's the one I want to go for. We have done a recording with Firefox, but I'm going to use the one I did with Fiddler. It doesn't make any particular difference, so you're welcome to use any of these. Just keep in mind that Chrome will not do a proper recording of response content, so you might want to avoid that if you want to use the advanced features of OctoPerf later on. And also, any recorder that can generate an HAR file is also fine. There are a few out there, open source recorder, that can do this. Anyway, let's go ahead and do it with Fiddler. I have the file on my disk right there, so I'm going to import this one, and let's go ahead. Once imported, we'll get to the design screen, and the first thing we can notice here on the design screen is that we have these containers and requests. Containers are a way to represent transactions or pages. We have automatically created the containers for you based on the timestamp during the recording. So if you don't have as many containers as you expect, try to pace your recording, go a bit slower between every click, and we'll do that automatically. Now, that being said, you probably notice that there are a lot of things here that are not related to the pet store. So these requests that are not related to the pet store, I don't want to replay them as part of my test. So to avoid doing this, the first step would be to go to Servers menu. And in there, I can select the host names I want to remove. In fact, the only one I want to keep is a pet store one. All the others are some kind of background process or another. So let's delete them all. It's warning me that I am removing 21 requests in the pet store script I just created, which is fine. That's what I want to do. So let's go ahead and do that. And then the only one that remained is the one going to the pet store itself. Just know that here you have a few options if you want to edit all your requests at once by changing these settings. But I'm going to leave it that way. It's perfectly fine for me. Now, if we check the containers, they only have pet store requests in them. The name may be a bit different because it contains a path of the first request that was inside it. So you might want to change that. Typically, what I like to do is put a number and a quick description of what it's doing. I know I first went to the home page, then I went to the login page. And I know after that, I went on to submit my login. Well, I could continue, but I think you get the idea. I will probably name them all after this video so that we have a nice report, but let's save a bit of time and continue for now. Now, a good first step on every new script we import would be to take care of all the dynamic parameters. And the first one I'm interested into is the login. And for the login, what I know so far is that I have used the default login in the pet store, which is J2EE. So I'm going to search for that in all requests to see which one is actually using it. Let's see what it does. When I close the search window, the search is launched automatically. It points me to this request. As you can see, it's marked right there. And while I'm on this request, let's have a look at all the different parameters we have. You have the path of the request. You have a name you can put on the request. Although I'd recommend naming the containers, that's usually enough. And you also have access to all the headers. Headers, most of the time, do not require anything. Most of the work required might be on the cookie header, but it's already handled automatically, so you shouldn't have to trouble yourself with that. If they require some work, we'll do exactly the same thing on post data, so y'all should be able to show you what it looks like. Before we get there, though, a word about think time, because this is a recorded delay between this request and the previous one. Here it's pretty short, probably because the previous one was one of the filtered requests. But it's not a problem because I can increase it right now here, stating I want 5 seconds, or I could put a random value between 2 and 5 seconds, for instance. We can also change that using the search and replace, and we'll also see later on the runtime screen we can do the same thing. Anyway, think time is a good way to have a real pause before this request, like a real user would do when entering data on the screen or thinking about this next step. And it's a good way to pace the execution of your user and have something realistic. Now let's talk about pause data. As I said, that's where we're likely to have our information because this is a pause request. And in there we can see we have a login, password, and a few other parameters, but for now, we'll be interested in having a dynamic login and not always the same one. And to do that, we need to have a list of values in OctoPerf, a list of credentials. And I'm going to do that with the variable menu right here by adding a CSV variable. A CSV variable, I can rename it, say it will be my list of accounts. Doesn't really matter though, it's just a display name here. The most important step is to pick a file. And I have one already ready here that I will import, credential.csv. The default sharing mode here ensures that every user will get a unique value, provided, of course, you have enough values in your dataset file. Otherwise, we will recycle, so we will reuse the values. Now, the next step would be to name them, and I will name them login and password. This is important because these values will be the variable names we use later on. We can see we have an overview of the file right there. And if you pay attention, you probably notice that some of these login and password look incorrect. This is done on purpose. We'll see later when we run a test that we have a few errors because of that. But anyway, that's for later. We're fine now. I can just close this window. And going back to the pause request here, I can just enter a dollar sign to open the auto completion menu. And this way I can pick from the variable list without having to enter a cumbersome syntax here with brackets and everything. I can also avoid any mistake this way because we will have only variable names that exist. Now let's see what it does in reality. I will replace this script once to check out what's going on. That's what we call the validate here. A validate user is actually a test with one user running. I'm running from Paris, but it doesn't really matter here. We'll talk more about on-premise agent later, but this list is to allow you to select where you want to run it from, including on-premise location that you might have installed. But that's convenient when the application is behind a firewall. Anyway, in my case, doesn't really matter. We can see it's being replayed right now. For now, we have green dots here, but it will update as it goes, of course. There's also a sanity check here that points us toward potential mistakes in the script we are working on. That's a very good way to find out if there's anything that might be a problem later on. For now, my validation is almost finished. I can see I have green dots everywhere, so it's a very good sign, but we'll see what that means. And now it's finished, so I can close this panel. I can also see it's finished because I have a notification. Let's clear that. Looking at our login request, if I check now the request and response tab, instead of just the recorded, I also have the validate now. You can see you have the timestamp as well in here. That's very interesting because this way I can compare what was going on during the runtime with the validation I just did. And you can see that I'm using a different login and password. In the response, what we can see is that we have the same response code, which explains why we have a green dot here, but also that, we were redirected to the same page and just the time is different, so it looks okay so far. Well, that's a very good first step for our script. Of course, we'll take it further in the next tutorials, particularly taking care of dynamic parameters such as this one. But that will be enough for this video where I wanted to show you how to use a dataset file. So thanks for watching, and I hope to see you soon on the OctoPerf tutorials. Thank you, bye-bye.